All right, and the excitement of genealogy. Oh my gosh, I'm just inundated with old photos, black and white, and I think I've selected through the best ones. That's all I'm gonna put out there. I can't do any more. My goodness. Okay, so I'm finding these things in these readings because as a child growing up, I didn't really listen to everything that spilled out of my grandmother's mouth or my grandfather or my mother, for that matter. But anyway, talking about this back to Chihuahua, back to Durango, back to Chupe, and they call it Chupe, it has many names, where they lived, actually. They lived several places in those mountains. And it's about 8,000 feet up, and there really is mountains, and there really is snow, and there really is water, rivers, and lumber. That was the reason for being there. He was in the lumber mill business. Now, yeah, another pet peeve of mine, but that was the way they made their living back then. Okay, so I guess we're looking at Chihui, Chupa, or there's a lot of spellings of it. Chihui, Chupa, and all of this is in these mountains of Mexico. You know, so they, what happened originally though? My great grandfather, Elias. No, not Elias, Elijah. He came from Alabama and he went to Salt Lake area. Now, in Alabama, he was supposed to stay there. Everything was fine. He had a house. He didn't have to leave. There was no reason for him to leave. But he decided to join the Mormon Church. And when he did this, his family is just like, that's it, we're disowning you. You're not with us anymore, you know. We don't really want the Mormon things or status or your way. And so off he went, and so he dropped his inheritance, he dropped his fortune, because they were a wealthy family from Alabama. Now this that doesn't mean that his brother did not go to Mexico. But for him, my great-grandfather, he chose the path of righteousness, Mormon style. And he took his wife, he got a wife there in this Mary Williams, pilgrim wife, from Arkansas. And so they got married there in the plains of Salt Lake Valley, area called the Cave Valley. I guess they called it Cave Valley, which could be somewhere closer to St. George, but it was there. And they lived a harsh life out there. They got married through a civil ceremony, and then later on it was official with the government, like, I don't know, 10 years later, another type of ceremony is the one that seems to be listed out here often. But what happened with them is they had a terrible life, and then, like I was saying about Mary Williams, and they end up going down to Mexico. And a lot of this was the polygamy was going out of style, and they decided they wanted to stay with polygamy. And so they went south. Now, Elijah, I'm not really sure if he was really into the polygamy or not. But what happened when he got there? He's still now he's been cut off from the family, so he's a poor bloke, and now he has this wife from Arkansas, and she's the one who descends from the kings of France, oddly, but descending, you know, strutting around still. He knows he descends from the kings of Scotland. And they name often in the paperwork this King John or whatever. So he still thinks he is somebody, even though And I guess it's still something they still keep dragging these kings around. So anyway, so off they go to these Sierra Madre mountains. And what happens there? Well, I guess what they get involved in, all of the sawmills, the lumber mills. Here it says, I don't know, I have to read it, I'm sorry. Here she says, she talks of herself, this is my mother, the butterfly who socialized in governor's circles. I was a highly respected daughter of a successful businessman, a lumberman, who held status and honorary positions in the community. Okay, so he was status and honorary positions. Besides founding several sawmills in the virgin forests of Durango, Sierra Madres. El Mister, they called him, and the families of means appointed him godfather of their children. So that was really about my grandfather. Now, he was also called Don Ricardo. And he really did, you know, get fashioned in the funny suits, like the Pancho Villa guy. And we talk about it, the funny suit, but really the funny suit wasn't a costume. He really did wear those outfits. And so that's interesting, that was just like, you know how you go to Switzerland and they wear the lederhosen? Well, he was wearing those outfits. It was really tight brocade pants and that's real tight, you know, mariachi style jackets and sombreros. Yeah, so here's Don Ricardo. He's my great grandfather. Now, he was called Don Guillermo, and I don't know why. It had nothing to do with his name, his last name, but they called him Don Guillermo. Now, he was an interesting fellow. Now, my grandfather was interesting a little bit, you know. He lost his positions at the sawmills, he went back to America, and then worked at Sears for a little bit, and then he got like a foreman job back in the mountains, and so he went, and he worked there, and then his son died in a terrible accident, and so then he went back to the United States. So it was kind of an upheaval life for him. It was not great, and he lost a whole bunch of money. But when it goes to my great-grandfather, Don Guillermo, he was interesting because not only did he was a dedicated fallout from that CV group. There was a group that fled and decided, that's it, they're going to be polygamists, nobody's going to tell them, no Book of Mormon is going to change and cannot tell them they cannot have dual wives. So he went because his father went to Mexico. So in this, he's being raised by this father who had three wives, and his third wife is his particular mother. So what happened with this Don Guillermo fellow, my exile? His name is William Exile. He lived in exile. He was given the name of Exile because he was the first child that was born in Mexico under the exile terms and conditions of the Mormon Church. So he was actually named Exile because of that. Now, what was interesting? Well, later in his life, in his 20s, 30s, he was kidnapped by banditos. Okay, so the banditos, they kidnap him, and they take him into a terrible situation. Handcuffed him, well, not handcuffed him, but, you know, roped his hands and all of the whole thing. And then they put out on the news that they had killed him because they didn't get the ransom money. They made a ransom money request. They put out on the news that he was dead. And they sent it out all across Mexico that William Exile had been killed by the banditos. And then they find out later, like, no, it was just that he did not have the money. And then they lowered the price. They lowered the price to $200. And then he was freed from the situation. But when they found out he didn't not have the thousands that they wanted, Anyway, so interesting fellow. So he does make the news, and I do have a news clipping of him somewhere. He was important at the time because everybody was like, oh my gosh, they killed the man, you know, the banditos. And when in reality he was still alive. So he lucked out. He was very lucky. Now, oddly, the same fellow died very young, though. He was only 44 years old. And he died of stomach troubles. So, yeah, they had a lot of problems with dying. The like my grandmother's first child, I believe it was either rheumatic fever, and that he died. And he was 3 years old, so she had her 3-year old die, and then she had her 14-year old die. In the motor scooter accident. So this is what I've been like swirling with in my head. And my mother was there in the middle of all of this, you know, trying to be lively and aware and awake and human and grow up and be a teenager and young woman, and her mother was just sad. She was sad because she lost her first child. She didn't really want my mother. Showing up, 3 years later, she didn't really want her. She wanted her little boy. And so she was just sad. And then Mary just, there was not much she could do for that, to cheer her up. And then later on, she loses, the whole family loses the boy. So we lost him and another. So it was an El Paso tragedy. Two boys were killed at one time. They were riding on a motor scooter. They had a paper route, and it was out on one of the major streets. I think it was early in the morning. I think it was a big truck, but they never actually found the driver, and so it just been one of those things, they never got their justice type of thing. And I don't know what they would do justice wise, the boy's dead, but two of them. So it was a hard hit for my mother, my grandmother. They were just like, my mother just, she's 8 and 8 and 8. She got fat and fat and fat, and she couldn't stop for about a year after that. She just got real fat. But she loved her brother. She adored him. And it was so strange because this motor scooter, he liked it at the beginning, He got this motor scooter and he liked it, but he didn't want to throw the papers from the motor scooter. He wasn't very good at it in the very beginning. And he even told his mother, he just said, I'd rather walk. I'd rather walk it. That's what he said. I'd rather walk it. Like his route was it. He didn't want to take that bike and throw the papers off. But I guess that was the fashion of the time. That's the way they did it. And you see that in those old movies. You know, they're just... And it wasn't that he was not skilled. He was very skilled. He in Mexico, he used to get on the shoulders of people on their bicycles, and they would play bicycle games that way. You know, play duel of two on the shoulders. But on this scooter, this motor scooter with the two boys, they were both killed. So yeah. It was a very bad time for my mom, because then she had a boyfriend in El Paso. Well, not really, you know, boyfriend, but you know, a flirt friend, and he went off Mount Franklin in a motorcycle. So for her, it was just like the 1950 time. It was hitting 1953 through 55. It was just awful. It was just awful. And she just gained a lot of weight. She was just losing good people. Anyway, so that's all I had to say. I did list a poem of my mother's, and that was kind of a good one. I liked it. It had a lot of her vigor and her vim in it. And so it was very, very expressive. I don't even know where I did with the poem paper, because I could read it to you right now, and I don't know where I put it. Maybe I'll put it back on a separate video, just the poem paper. But yeah, the family was really, really hit hard, because the father, grandfather, was gone in Mexico at work while all this was happening, while his son was killed. And so, I don't know. I guess it's odd too, you know, the whole thing, him being a paper route that ended up being his death, and the father's out there in the lumber yard business making the paper. I mean, it's just too horrible, isn't it? It's just too horrible. Anyway, I didn't mean to end with that. I know, I hate all this family, what do we call it? Family have to? I am stuck with genealogy, like I'm in a genealogy swamp. I don't know. I like the online family search. I can at least put those things out there now. I don't have to be worried if a bomb blows them up. They'll be out there on the internet. So, I don't know. There's a lot of things, and letters. They sent so many letters. The family sent so many letters to each other, you know. They were just that way, because they didn't have television sets back then. And I don't want to throw away the letters, but I don't want to read any of them either. So it's just, I am a kind of a strange historian, because I don't want to go through it all. There's just too much, you know. I'm inundated by their release. They have to talk all the time in writing. I'm inundated by it. And I guess that's the way it was, you know, they didn't have telephones to communicate, you know, it was just a lot of writing. But tough. It was a tough time, yeah. And I don't think my grandfather ever got over it. He was always on this mind thing. I never gave permission for him to buy the bike. I never, you know, never gave permission. So yeah, he was always, you know, never really able to deal with it in his life. You know, didn't accept it. Did not accept it. You know, because if he had given him permission, that would be different. But he did not give him permission. Therefore, in a way, his son was wrong. His son was wrong, and maybe that alleviated some of his pressure as in pain, as losing him. I don't know, to lie to himself, you know. But well, he didn't lie. He didn't give him permission. But in those days, either they probably could have sued the company. I believe it was Sears where they bought the bike. but I don't know. I don't know. You know, when that happens, I think the family just was too much caught up in, oh my God, he's dead, like forever, that I don't think they could go and make lawsuits or anything, you know. I'm sorry, I know my video is really weirdly ghosted out, but this, I don't know, I have a new OS upgrade, and it doesn't like my video machine player, so I'm on the fuzzy one. Okay, at least I got the fuzzy one to work. Yay. I don't know. I think my grandfather, though, had another wife. My mother always said he had another wife in Mexico. I think I found pictures of her and the two girls. So I did locate two girls. I don't know the wife's name, but I believe she was a blonde. And, yeah, the two girls were about, I don't know. I don't know the age of the two girls, but similar age to my mother. Similar age. So all of this polygamy thing was going on around that time. Yeah, so I don't know what happened to them. I don't even know their names. But it's very exciting. I'm going to find out through this this ancestry. They're going to tell me if I'm more Indian, if there was a hidden Indian in the mix. Because when they left, when they all had to make an exodus out of Mexico, it was 1912 and 1919, they went to Arizona. Many of them went to Arizona. Now, in Arizona, there was an attack by Indians. Now, these Indians, they don't know if they were rogue Indians or what, or angry Indians from the Geronimo Apaches. That's what they were alluding to. But they apparently tomahawked two women. And that, to me, seemed absolutely brutal. And I'm like, if they tomahawked two women, like completely, you know, killed them outside their house as they were standing up against a wall, it sounds like it was a killing different, almost like a revenge kill. And the boy, there was a little boy that survived. He ran to my Mary Williams' house, and he said, "There are very mean Indians at my house. Mean Indians." So we don't know if that was the mother whisking him off, saying, "Just get out of here, go to Mary's," or. He saw, or he was a witness, or hid, or anything. But I have a feeling he was possibly raised by Mary. And that's interesting, because I just now uploaded a picture of her, and I found another child in it that was very similar age to my mother. And I don't know who the kid was. I don't know who he is. So, yeah. Anyway, could be the little boy or not. Oh, no, it could not be. No, my mom wouldn't be around that time. I'm sorry. No, it wasn't that kid. So no, we don't have a picture of the little boy. But there was a little boy that escaped, and there was his mother and his grandmother were killed by Indians. So there were some mean ones out there. However, Mary Williams and her husband, Elijah, they lived with the Cave Valley Indians in Utah, so they had a very good experience. So it just depended on which Indian group was your group, you know. So, anyway, that's it for today, I guess, on history of, what am I history of? The down to Durango, Chihuahua, to the Chihuahua Chupi Mountains. I think they're the marijuana mountains now, and I think they're run by drug lords. That's one of the reasons it's not really advised to go travel there. So don't go to those Williams Mountains. And then Dantria. What was the other thing? Oh, back here, back to the southwest, over to a little bit of Arizona I talked about. And oh, one thing neat I did notice is if Jake, he's out there, he's with the Garden Channel of Phoenix. He's the garden guy of Phoenix. Now he looks very similar to my grandfather in profile, and it freaks me out. It's almost like my grandfather's son. It's that uncanny. So he could very well come from that same time frame, the line, and so we could be related somehow, either like my grandfather's, one of my grandfather's brothers. Oh my gosh, he had a lot, a lot of brothers. So yeah, and that's it. I think that's it for history today. And I went, did I go to the north? I went even into Utah, even got into Utah to Cave Valley. And I even went over to Alabama. So it was kind of an exciting history chat, wasn't it? Yes, yes, okay. Oh my gosh, yeah, Don Ricardo. How neat. And Don Guillermo, and they named them, and when they were born also, they named them the Spanish names. So when you're looking, if you're a genealogist, look for the Spanish name, because my grandfather was named Ricardo, not Richard. He was Ricardo at birth, and that particular thing probably threw a lot of people off for a long time. Oh, one more thing. I'm sorry. I do have this. Yeah, it's a baby. There's a little baby. Okay, it's 1958. This is too recent, so I can't actually name the names. But it's a friend of my mother's. And her particular name, she uses her mother's maiden name second. And then she uses her husband's name last. But her father's name is not listed. So on this little, she had a baby. She only lists her mother's name as her middle maiden name. So it's the maiden name of the mother in this region with the socialite group. The socialite group of where are they? Torreon. They're in Torreon. Okay. So yeah, so that's odd to me, because we're always looking for the father as being the maiden name in the middle, but it's not in this case. It's the mother's. Castillo, I'll give you a hint.